I've had a few people recently saying that they want me to do some videos about dyeing leather. A lot of people still seem to be struggling with sort of what type of dye they need and what's the best way to apply it and those sorts of things. I'm going to do a couple of videos. This first video we're actually going to look at airbrushing, purely because I had some airbrushing to do today, so I thought I'd film what I was doing and we could have a look at the video. Now airbrushing leather is another one of those things that you don't have to do it, and the majority of people never will do it, but if you're wanting to sort of broaden the range of things that you can do, there's certain things that you can do with an airbrush that you can't really do in any other way. So it opens up some sort of techniques to you that you can use to expand the variety of things that you can do. Now I'm not any sort of an airbrush artist. There's quite a big difference. To me the airbrush is just a tool, and it will be I'll show you how we use it for sort of dyeing and creative dyeing. A lot of people do really fancy things with airbrushes. If you watch like American Chopper and that on Discovery and you see Mr. Nubs on there doing the bikes, you know, he does fantastic things with his airbrush, and he can make things look like snake skin and metal work, and he does all sorts of skulls and logos and all different things like that. That's not something that I do with leather. I don't have the talent to do it. Don't class myself as an artist, and I wouldn't know where to start. So we're not looking at anything like that. Although I'm sure if you wanted to learn how to do that, you could do. We're purely going to look at sort of what an airbrush is, how it works, what different kinds there are, what it costs, what you can spray through it, and what it will, just as a leather worker, allow you to do. So we'll start off by looking at what an airbrush actually is, what parts of it there are, and then we'll look at what we can do with it then. So there's various different parts to an airbrush system, and some of the parts you can use different things. So you know, you can do airbrushing using a sort of just a tank of compressed air, or a small canister of compressed air, or like a mains system or something like that. What I got with mine, which is the most common thing that you'd have with a sort of small scale or hobbyist type of airbrush setup, is a little compressor like this. Like any air compressor, this basically just takes in atmospheric air, compresses it down, and then it can eject it at a higher pressure than it would be normally. So obviously it's electric, you plug it in, and then it's got an on-off switch to actually turn it on. It's got a pressure gauge on, which tells you how much pressure there is, and then it's got a hose here, and the hose is what you connect to your actual airbrush. This is the airbrush itself. You can see there's a connector underneath here, and that is where your connection goes from your compressor. So you take the hose from the compressor and simply and carefully screw that onto the bottom of the airbrush there. And then when you turn the compressor on, it'll actually move up to pressure. And then once it's got to whatever pressure it's set to, it'll actually cut out then. So that's moved up there to the pressure that I've set it to, and there is now pressure actually going into this airbrush. If we operate the airbrush, you can hear that the air comes out of the airbrush, and as soon as you start to use the air, the compressor there will then come back into action and top the pressure back up. You need to make sure that the compressor can actually cope with the maximum setting that you want to use on the airbrush. So if I was to spray as much as possible through this airbrush, you need to make sure that this needle doesn't actually fall down to zero, because that means you're spraying air faster than the compressor can compress the air, and that means that the compressor is actually inadequate. If you buy everything together as a kit like I did, then obviously the compressor that's supplied should be adequate to use with the airbrush that's supplied. If you were using a much larger airbrush, if you were spraying something like a car or a motorbike, obviously you'd have a much bigger compressor, but for a small airbrush like this, a small compressor's fine. So if we take a closer look at the airbrush itself, as I said, the connection on the bottom there is for your actual air source. There's another threaded connection on the side here, and that's where you actually put your paint source or your dye source or whatever it is that you want to spray. There's various different things that you can attach to these. The one that I use usually is this little kind of bottle, little sort of siphon bottle thing. So you just pop your dye in there, pop the connection together like that, pop the ring over, and then actually screw the ring in, and that brings that up tight. I use this because you can get quite a lot of dye in there, so if you're wanting to do quite a big job, you can get plenty in. You can also get a little kind of gravity cup thing for smaller amounts, which then points upwards and just sort of gravity feeds down. On top of the actual airbrush itself is this piece here, which is called the trigger, and that's what you use to actually operate the airbrush then. It doesn't do anything when it's not being touched. You have to use the trigger to actually operate that through. On the back of the airbrush here is a little adjuster which turns, and that's to set the maximum amount that you can open the airbrush, which is something that we'll talk about in a minute. As you move this trigger back, you're actually spraying more air through. If you want to limit how much you can spray through, you can kind of wind this up, and then the trigger doesn't move back as far. So that's just like a limiter as such. So there are two types of airbrush, as in this part of the airbrush, that you can buy in this style. You can get ones that are called single action and ones that are called double action. The difference between a single action and a double action is that with a single action airbrush, all you can do with the trigger is just press it straight down. When you press it straight down, it will spray a predefined amount of paint or dye through, and when you let go, it stops. With a double action airbrush, you can push it down to actually initiate the airflow, and then the amount that's sprayed through, rather than being predefined, you operate by moving the trigger forwards and backwards. So when you press it down and the trigger's forwards this way, no dye will actually come through. The more you move this trigger backwards towards the back of the airbrush, the more dye that will come through. So really it depends on what you want to do with the airbrush as to whether you want a single or a double action one. A single action one is certainly easier to use because you don't need to sort of learn the trigger control as such, but it does mean that every time you want to adjust how much dye you're using, you've got to either fiddle about with an adjuster on the back, or you've got to turn it off and change that and start going again. I think it's worth just getting a double action one, to be honest, learning and practicing how to do the trigger control forwards and backwards, and then it means less stopping and starting when you're doing your dyeing. And if you want to adjust it slightly, you can just use your finger rather than doing a lot of messing about. So I would recommend that you get a double action one, but it's not completely necessary for the kind of things that you might do. So when you're actually using your airbrush, in terms of the effect that you're getting, there's three things that you can vary as you're airbrushing. You can vary the amount of dye that you're applying, you can vary the speed that you're moving the airbrush, and you can vary the distance from the workpiece that you've got the airbrush. And it's the combination of those three things together which defines sort of what you're actually doing on the piece. And you can obviously, the more skillful you get with it, the more you can vary those things at the same time. So you could vary the speed and the amount together to do kind of tapered lines and those sorts of things if you find that you need to. The other thing that you will need if you're airbrushing is a proper face mask, and that's extremely important because you're basically atomizing a kind of poisonous dye as such, and if you breathe that into your lungs, it's going to give you serious health problems. So you absolutely must use a proper face mask. That doesn't mean one of these cheap kind of £2 dust mask things that you might use if you're doing a bit of drilling. You need one of these, which is a proper decent quality face mask. It's got a full a full nose and mouth cover that creates a proper seal around your mouth. It's all adjustable, and then it's got replacement gas and particulate filters on the front. It's going to cost you something like, I think I probably paid about £35 for this whole thing. But you absolutely must use a proper face mask, otherwise you can do yourself serious damage, as I say. In terms of where you do your airbrushing as well, whatever you do, don't just do it inside without ventilation, or open the window a bit and do it inside, because your whole house or whatever is going to just get full of atomised dye and cause people problems. Basically, you either need a properly ventilated workspace with like a proper decent sort of semi-industrial extractor going on, which I haven't got, or you just do it outside, which is what I do. Obviously, that means you need some nice weather and it can't be really windy and stuff, but you know, the alternative isn't to do it inside your house if you haven't got the right area set up. So just wait until it's a nice day and then go and do it outside with your mask on, and then you're not causing any problems. So in terms of what you can actually push through an airbrush, as I was learning about this, the general guideline for these kind of airbrushes seems to be anything that's the consistency of milk or less, in terms of like how viscous it is. So all these kind of normal dyes, like your oil dyes, or your Fibins water-based dyes, the eco dyes, those sorts of things you can spray straight through, no problem at all. Something like the cover colours, which you use for sort of painting on your leather, those are, as you can see, not the consistency of milk. They're much thicker, so I don't think you'd get away with spraying those through an airbrush like that. I think they'd be too thick. I haven't actually tried, but as I say, the guideline was a sort of milky type consistency, so it needs to be basically anything that's like thin and watery or oily, rather than sort of thick paints, as I understand it. So in terms of things you can actually do with your airbrush then, once you know, if you decide you want to buy one, then you get the setup, you've got the face mask and everything, what can you actually do with it? As I say, we're not talking about like, you know, airbrushing super detailed skulls and things, we're talking about sort of basic things that that everyday people might want to do as a like a craftsperson rather than an artist as such. Now, one of the easiest and things you can do with it is just to use it for flat dyeing. If you do find that you struggle using sort of wool daubers or using rags or anything else to apply your dye flat, and you don't want to do dip dyeing because you haven't got enough dye or you haven't got the setup for that, you can just use it for doing flat dye. If you want to do flat brown, flat black, flat saddle tan, or anything like that, you can use your airbrush for that. I don't struggle to do sort of darker colours in flat dyeing, so if you're doing your sort of your dark browns and your blacks, applying it with the daubers is very easy. One thing that I do use the airbrush for though is lighter colours, things like your light browns and your saddle tans, or if you want a very light mahogany type colour. The reason for that is that when you apply dye with a wool dauber or with a cloth, there's kind of a minimum amount of dye that's going to go on there, sort of, and it's quite a lot. So as soon as you put that dauber in and start to apply it, you're actually putting quite a lot of dye on there. And so if you're trying to do a light brown and you do want to keep it quite light, you'll find that although it says light brown on the dye pot, by the time you've run that dauber around it a few times to get it even, it's not actually that light of a brown. When you use your airbrush, because you can limit the amount of dye that's going on there, and you can also do it quite evenly, you'll find that with a few passes you can actually get a nice light brown colour that's very even. You haven't put too much dye on, and it's probably the light brown that you had in your mind as such, rather than you know, rather than having applied too much dye. Thank you. The second thing that we can use it for is stenciling kind of effects. Often with airbrushing, rather than using the word stencil, they use the word shield as well. So if you're trying to sort of Google for some of this stuff, you might find that if you type airbrush shield, you actually get more information. And you'll be able to see here a couple of examples of this. You can obviously use a kind of sort of inside stencil, like those ones you had at school when you kind of, you know, you drew inside the letters to do neat letters. That would be sort of going inside. Or you can also go around the outside of something. And you can obviously layer up the colours for this, so you could do like a base coat and then put your stencil on, do your darker outside, or those kind of things. You can do a darker inside, or however you want to layer up your colours. So this is an example of a stencil piece that I did quite a while ago, which has got little spider bugs on. And this was made by laser cutting the spider bugs out of a sheet of mount board cardboard, and laying the mount board over the leather and then spraying through to the spider bugs. And there's actually a video where you can see me doing this. This is another stencil piece that I did. This time it was to make a desert camouflage effect. What I did was I actually made two separate types of camouflage stencil. And I did the base coat to the leather, and then I did two different types of camouflage in two different colours. So this is actually quite a layered effect, which worked quite well. The final thing that you tend to do with the airbrushing, or I tend to do, is you can do quite a nice blend or sunburst effect, depending on what you want to call it. Say you wanted a kind of lighter inside to your piece, and then you wanted to do like a dark border. That is very difficult to do with a wool dauber or with a rag, because you're going to get kind of quite a hard line. You can't do any sort of gradient really with a wool dauber. As soon as you apply it and start to run it down your piece, it's going to make quite a very solid line, and the dye is going to run and seep, and you can't do like a gradient effect with it. It just doesn't work. What you can do with an airbrush is you can dye something like a light colour, and then you can basically very slowly work around the outside, darken the border around the outside to sort of whatever distance you like, and then you can very finely apply sort of a mist of dye and take your time with it. And what you can do is you can then build up a transition from one to the other. That creates a nice sunburst effect, like you'd get on a nice Fender guitar. And depending on which colours you pick, that can either be quite subtle, so you can have a dark brown with a black working in, which would be, you know, quite a subtle transition. Or you could do something where it was a really light middle and a very dark outside, and that'd be a bit more striking, depending on the type of thing that you're wanting to do. Here you can actually see the sunburst effect being applied. This is obviously sped up a little bit because you do have to take your time when you're doing this, but you can see how it sort of builds up quite nicely. And then this is a photograph just after that just being applied there. This is another example here. This one's like a sunburst effect. You can just see sort of the lighter middle and the darker outside, and you can see the way that there's a nice transition made between the two, depending on which colours you choose.